that you will use us to bring forth a word.
Lord.
We get discouraged on the way. Sometimes we give up on the way. Sometimes we just quit altogether. But, oh Lord, we don't want to give up.
No.
And, oh Lord, we don't want to quit. But we want to trust in you. Bless, Lord, as we declare the word that you have given us. In Jesus' name.
Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
And amen.
Amen.
I wasn't around when they designed the pulpit, and it wasn't made for someone as small as I am, but we're going to do the best we can with a loud voice and singing. Amen. Praise the Lord. To our pastor and first lady in their absence, we received a phone call, and I got to talk to pastor, and pastor said, "Little preacher, preach." Pastor and I go back to 1980, and I started preaching before he did. So now he's entrusted Minister Brown, myself, and Minister Manning to hold the fort down until they're able to come back. And we're going to do the best we can. To our officers and our deacons and our members and our friends and our internet-based community, I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. In your bulletin, we have selected some scriptures, and I'm going to read selected ones out of that is printed in the bulletin. We're going to look at the first one, the second one, and the third one on the first page, and then we're going to do the last three on the second page. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. But without faith, it is impossible to please him, for he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and not of yourselves, it is a gift of God. Then on the second page of the reading, therefore we also, since we are surrounded with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that does so easily ensnares us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Looking unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your soul. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. As I go into this dissertation for today, I want to stay focused on the pastor's vision and the pastor's theme of learning, growing, and maturing.
Yes.
As we have been called, chosen, and committed. In preparation for this message, I pray that God would give me a word of hope and encouragement that would be conducive for such a time that we are living in today.
Yes.
As we revisit this familiar segment of scriptures, that you will be motivated to look to Jesus in all that you do. Every time we turn on the news and look at the newspaper or search the internet, you hear or read of people being robbed, raped, molested, killed, more drive-by shootings, an increase in gang violence, and too much black-on-black killing. Moreover, too many of our youth and young adults are becoming statistics in the numbers of inmates in the various correction facilities. We are disturbed by an unstable economy, a jacked-up housing market, and a tragedy in our job sector. Chaos and confusion are the order of the day. Wars and rumors of wars are an indication that we are living in the last days. With so many false teachers and false prophets and false religions and twisted opinions on many issues, we are living in a time when right is wrong and wrong is right. And I'm inclined to agree, and the implications are obvious that if we ever needed the Lord before, we sure do need Him now. In my study and preparation time, God has given me a word, and no matter how bad our situation is, God is still in control. Psalms 24:1, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. I want to encourage you that there is hope in a hopeless situation. If we just learn to trust God and lean and depend on Him, things will get better. Proverbs 3:5-6, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding, and in all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path. Now look at Hebrews 12:2, and that first part on the second side of the reading inside of the bulletin. It says, looking unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith. And with that being said, we want to use for a theme, a thought, a topic, a subject, the Anchor Man. Look at your neighbor and say, the Anchor Man. When you think of running or being in a race, the one thing that comes to mind is a relay team. There are four runners, and each one has their turn to pass the baton to the next runner until they get to the anchor man, the one who is the fastest, the strongest, the smartest, the one with the experience and the ability to size up the competition and win the race. The anchor man. As I go into this message, I want to paint the picture of using a coaching perspective. A good coach trains their athletes to be winners, to be the best that they can be. In our history, it gives us to know that 83 years ago, God gave Pastor C.H. Gordon a vision to establish the St. Mark Missionary Baptist Church. And for 14 years, he pioneered and developed the growth of this body of baptized believers until God called him home. The baton was passed to Pastor Floyd, and
right.
He continued the work for 2 years. And again, the baton was passed on to the late, great Freeman R. Williams, who for 44 years took St. Martin's to the next level. Finally, the baton has been passed to Pastor Percy Harper, and over the last 23 years, it has been his responsibility to take St. Mark to a higher height in Jesus' name.
Amen.
The anchor man, the fastest, the strongest, the smartest, the one with the experience and the ability to size up the contest and win the race.
Yeah.
Imagine with me, if you will, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost, the Blessed Trinity. God is the team manager, and Jesus is the team captain, and the Holy Ghost is the trainer, and I want to consider Pastor Harper the head coach and acknowledge that all of the ministers make up the assisting coaching staff, and it is our responsibility to teach you to be the best Christian that you can be, learning and growing and maturing. The anchor man.
Right.
The most important step that I want to discuss that we need to sign up for God's team.
Yes.
Someone wrote the song, Sign Me Up for the Christian
Jubilee.
Write my name on the road. We all want to go to heaven when we die, but we're not willing to take those steps to get us there.
That's true.
And I stop by today to tell you that the most important question is, how do I get on God's team?
The answer
is by receiving Him as Lord and Savior and having a personal relationship with Him. This is the most important decision and the best choice you could ever make in your life.
Yes,
young or old, we need to accept Him and receive the gift of eternal life. If we reject Him, we will have eternal separation and destruction in the lake of fire. And we have several steps that are required. Step number one is admit that you are a sinner. Accept Him into your life. Romans 3:23 says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We are all sinners, and at one time or another we have fallen short and are unworthy of His love. Step number two, believe by faith that Jesus is the Son of God. He died, He was buried, He rose again, that you might have eternal life.
Thank you.
This is 2 and 8. For by grace are you saved through faith, and it's not of yourself, but it's a gift of God. Corinthians 15:3-4. For I deliver unto you first of all which I have received, that Christ died according to the Scripture. He was buried, and He rose again on the third day according to the Scripture. Point number three, confess Him before men. Romans 10:9-10, that if thou confess the Lord with thy mouth and believe in thy heart that God has raised Him from the dead, you shall be saved.
Yes.
With the heart man believeth unto righteousness. With the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. Romans 10 and 13. For whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. It is a matter of confession. Lord, save me. And now that we have joined God's team, we have these 3 points that I want to cover. Point number one, we have to do our warm-up exercise. Point number two, we have to practice. And point number three, we must perform.
That's right.
We have to do our warm-up exercise. That is a part of learning. We have to practice. That is a part of growing. And we have to perform. And that is a part of maturing.
Yes, it is.
Point number one, if you will, we have to do our warm-up exercise.
Well, brother preacher, what is
our warm-up exercise? I'm glad you there are a series of stretches and range of motion exercises that we must put our body through in order to practice or compete. Our warm-up exercise is praise and worship. In the sports world, there is always a crowd of excited fans, and during this 2012 Olympics, I watched them jumping up and down and hollering and screaming and shouting and high-fiving and hugging one another because they were excited that their team was winning, and they were cheering them on to victory. The thing that fascinates me is that these events are pretty much packed out. Be it a game or a concert, they come together to cheer and have a good time. With that thought in mind, when we come to the house of God, we look so sad and we are so quiet, you can almost hear a pin drop. When we learn our warm-up exercise, that series of stretch and range of motion exercise that puts our body through in order to practice or compete. So our first warm-up exercise is called gladness. Psalms 121:1, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Our next warm-up exercise is lifting your hands. 34:2, lift your hands in the sanctuary and bless the Lord. And then our next exercise is clapping your hands. Psalms 47:1 says, clap your hands, all ye people, and shout unto God the voice of triumph. The next warm-up exercise are a series of joyful and loud voices, rejoicing and singing praise. And Psalms 98:4, make a joyful noise unto the Lord all the earth. Make a loud noise and rejoice and sing praise. Philippians 4:4 says, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. This is the word is telling us that we should rejoice and we should shout and we should clap our hands and we should wave our hands and we should make a joyful noise unto the Lord and that we should make a loud noise unto the Lord with rejoicing and singing. Psalms 34, 1 and 3. I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. Oh, magnify the Lord. Exalt his name together. The redeemed of the Lord. As we conclude our warm-up exercise, we should be excited because our star player and team captain is in the house. In order to be good at anything, you have to practice.
Yes, you do.
If you want to be a good singer, you have to practice.
Yes, you do.
If you want to be a good writer, you have to practice. So, in order for us to be able to run this race and be a good Christian, we must practice. And in order for us, we have to learn certain techniques that are required to help us excel in the sport. And on this Christian journey, we have to practice. We have to practice going to church. Hebrews 10 and 25. Forsake not the assembling of yourselves together as the manner of some is, but encouraging one another as the day is approaching. We can no longer be pop-up Christians. Popping up on Christmas. Popping up on Easter. Popping up on Mother's Day. Popping up on all the other special occasions. Jesus, our anchor man, is coming back, and we should be on our A game. And in order to do that, we have to practice.
Yes,
we must practice and study our training material, which is the Word of God. And in this, we will learn the techniques that are required to help us excel in this spiritual race. 72 and 15 tells us to practice studying. Studying to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. We must practice praying. Acts 6 and 4. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer, to the ministry of the word. 1 Thessalonians 5 and 7 says, pray without ceasing. And Mark 11 and 24, therefore I say unto you, that what things soever you desire when you pray, believe you receive them, and you will have them. And as we practice praying and we begin to develop that technique and that ability to gain favor from God to help us make it to the end. In addition to that, I am a firm believer that Prayer changes things. If you ever want to beat that old slew-footed devil, now is the time that we show enough need to pray. And the last phase of our practice is that we need to understand that we need to practice walking in the Spirit.
That's right.
Galatians 5, 22 and 23, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, meekness, temperance. There is no law. Here, based on our training manual, the BIBLE, which is our basic instruction before leaving Earth, we learn the importance that the Christian character is produced by the Holy Spirit. And as we practice, we find out that joy is love's strength. And
that's right.
As we practice, we discover that peace is love's security. And as we practice, we learn that long-suffering is the love of God's patience.
As
we practice, we understand that gentleness is love's conduct. As we practice, we learn that God's goodness is love's character. As we practice, we comprehend that faith is love's confidence. And as we practice, we are sustained that the meekness of love is humility. And as we practice, we will be assured that temperance is love's victory. So remember, we must practice. And finally, point number three, we must perform. The day of the race is upon us. And we've done all that we need to do to get prepared, and it's almost showtime. And we've done our warm-up exercises, and we've mastered praise and worship, and we've practiced, and we've learned the techniques to help us excel in this spiritual race. Now, our team manager, God, and Jesus, the captain, and the Holy Spirit, who have trained and put their combined efforts to put together the best team possible with the dynamics of learning, growing, and maturing. In the language of the text, in Hebrews 12 and 1, we are surrounded by a crowd of witnesses. Look at that in two ways. One, you read chapter 11, and they call it the Heroes Hall of Fame, and Abraham, and Isaac, and Jacob, and all of the saints of old who looked forward to Jesus, but did not get to see him. And then, everywhere we go, people are looking at us. They're watching us to see if we are who we claim to be. And we must understand that we have to be careful of the weight.
That's right.
The Bible talks about weight, and the Bible talks about sin that does so easily beset us. So we got two dynamics that are coming against us. Our weights are the cares of this world. Our weights could be our job. Our weights could be our homes. Our weights could be our husbands. Our weights could be our wives. Our weights are anything that we put before God. And then the sin is a lack of faith.
Yes, it is.
Sin is, we do not demonstrate what we know that God has empowered us to do. We have two sins. We have omission And that is that we just don't do what we know we're supposed to do.
That's right.
And then we have commission, and we just do what we know we're not supposed to do. On this spiritual race,
yes,
we all have to run.
Yes, we do.
And each of us has been blessed and gifted with talents, skills, and abilities.
Yes, we have.
And he's counting on each one of us to take that he has gifted us with to do a work for him.
Yes.
The Bible says, looking unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith. And on this spiritual journey, it talks about running, and running is an action verb. And if you did see any of the running in the Olympics, you did not see anyone sitting down in the middle of their race because they had a prize.
Come on, man.
And concentrating and trying to reach it at the finish line. We have to have the same mentality.
Yeah.
We've been blessed and gifted and talented, and Ecclesiastes 10:9-10 said, whatsoever your hand finds to do,
come on,
do it with all your might.
Uh-huh.
He didn't say do it when you feel like it.
Uh-huh.
He didn't say I'll think about doing it.
Uh-huh.
He didn't say I'll do it next week.
Uh-huh.
He said do it with all your might.
Thank you.
For there is no work,
uh-huh,
nor device, nor knowledge, nor wisdom in the grave where thou goest. Then back to our text. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him. Now Jesus knew he was going to die. Jesus knew he was going to be persecuted. Jesus knew he was going to be tortured. He knew he was going to have to go from courthouse to courthouse, but he endured the cross.
He despised
the shame.
He seated
at the right hand of the throne of God. Here we are to focus and we are to concentrate on Jesus, just as the runner is focused on the finish line. The word tells us to focus on Jesus, the one who is the fastest, the one who is the strongest, the one who size up the competition and win the race. Stay focused on Jesus. And because of the joy that was before him, he endured the cross. He contended with that shameful death. But hallelujah! At the right hand of the Father. Lastly, for consider him that endured the contritions of sinners against himself, lest you get weary and faint in your mind.
Yes.
This is just a reminder of the price he had to pay.
Yes.
Sometimes we feel like giving up, remember, Jesus is the one that we are looking to. Jesus is the one who is the fastest. Jesus is the one who is the strongest. Jesus is the one that has the ability to rise up the competition and win the race. As I hurry to a close, lest I keep you too long, we must remember to look unto Jesus, the author and
God.
Uh-huh.
The one who healed the sick and raised the dead and the disciples of mine. Jesus, the anchor man, he realized that in order to make this thing complete, he had to go to the cross.
Yeah.
He hung and he bled and he died. I put him in a borrow tomb. I like that term, borrow.
Yeah.
You borrow something, it means you're going to give it back. All we have to do is look unto Jesus. He stayed around on the earth for a little bit, but then he stepped on the clouds and he went back.
Uh-huh.
According to the scripture, he's now seated at the right hand of the Father.
Yeah.
When it's time, there's going to be a shout.
Yeah.
The archangel is going to blow the trumpet.
Yeah.
And the dead in Christ are going to rise first.
Yeah.
And then we the great banquet is in place.
Yeah.
We've already been invited.
Right.
And now all we want to do is hear that welcome voice.
Yeah.
Well done. That little bit that you had, you did marvelous things with it. That little bit that you had, you did great things with it.
Mm-hmm.
Now enter into my joy,
yes,
where there is rest,
yay,
forever and ever and ever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's all because of the anchor. The anchor man decided that he wasn't going to run the last race. Suppose he decided he wasn't going to put on his uniform and show up at the competition. Then we'd be lost eternally. But he knew too much was at stake. He knew too much was on the line. And he gave his all and all that we can enjoy all of heaven. So let us always remember, no matter how difficult it is, look unto Jesus.
Yeah.
Yes.
Look unto Jesus. Look unto Jesus.
Yes.